Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, yeah.
Good morning. Welcome to this gathering of Holiday Bible Church. We're glad that you were able to make it, brave the heat and everything. A couple of announcements for us. If you did not get the email or the text message regarding the service ministry opportunities, let me know. Let one of us know afterwards, either one of the elders, one of the deacons. We'd love to get that information to you. There was a fantastic response, though, so we appreciate all of you who did sign up and did offer to serve in the various areas where we could use some help. And I know the deacons are excited about that, and we thank you for your willingness to serve. We do have Discovering God Hour following the morning service. I know that's been kind of on and off the last couple of weeks, but we will pick up in our study of church history following the service this morning. So, we look forward to that. And then Wednesday night, something a little different we need to be aware of, kind of came up all of a sudden, and that is a joint praise and testimony service with Keystone Bible Church this Wednesday night. So if you don't know where that is, we did put some directions on the table in the lobby, right where the hand sanitizer is. So if you can find the hand sanitizer, you will locate the directions and how to get there. So that is this coming Wednesday night. The time is different as well. It's 6:30, not 7 o'clock, which I know will make things a bit challenging for some. It's going to make them a little more challenging for me, but we'll try to be there. And if we're running a little late, then we just are, because it's holiday and that's how we roll, right? All right, let's turn our attention to worshiping the Lord. Psalm 134 says, "Praise the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Give praise, O servants of the Lord, who stand in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of our God. Praise the Lord, for the Lord is good. Sing to his name, for it is pleasant. For the Lord has chosen Jacob for himself, Israel as his own possession. For I know that the Lord is great and that our Lord is above all gods. Whatever the Lord pleases, he does in heaven and on earth, in the seas and all deeps. He it is who makes the clouds rise at the end of the earth, who makes lightnings for the rain and brings forth the wind from his storehouses." We serve a great God who is worthy to be praised by his people. And our joy this morning is found in the fact that we, as Gentiles, have been grafted into this tree of promises that were for David and his household. And so this goodness of God is for us this morning. And we praise his name that through Christ, we are made partakers. We are his people. Let's bow and let's praise this God this morning together in our praying. Lord, you are worthy of all of our worship. You are worthy of all of our praise. As the psalm says, you control all things. You do whatever pleases you in heaven and on earth, on the sea and into the depths of the sea. Lord, nothing happens on this earth apart from your sovereign will. And that sovereign will is always good. You are good, and all that you do is good. And so, Lord, for your goodness, for your sovereign goodness, we give you praise this morning. We praise you for your goodness in bringing to us salvation, that we who were outside the household of faith, we who were aliens and strangers, have been brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, you truly are good. We pray that you would lift our hearts as we sing your praises this morning. We pray that we would leave more convinced than ever of your sovereign goodness. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand and sing of the sovereign creation of our God. Creation sings the Father's song.
Unveiled the Father's plan of reconciling.
only does Scripture teach us that God is sovereign over all creation, but God is sovereign over our salvation. And in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, death was arrested and our new life in Christ begins. So let's sing, Death Was Arrested. Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope, no place to begin. Your love made a way, let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He called me dead, he called me his friend. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes God's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, last week we finished up the book of 1 Peter in our congregational scripture reading, and so we're moving this morning to the Gospel of John. So we'll be reading this morning John 1, verses 1 through 13. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness, to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God.
Just gain.
Lamb who gave his life for us, who demands our all, is worthy of all our worship and praise, not only in heaven for all eternity, but even this morning and tomorrow morning and Tuesday morning and all week long. Worthy is the Lamb. Worship your Christ this morning, the Son, the treasure of heaven, whom you sent to this world to be despised and rejected, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Thank you that he willingly took our sins and bore them on the cross, satisfying the wrath of God that we deserved. He absorbed it all, and he gives us fellowship and a renewed relationship with you for all eternity. I pray that if there's someone here this morning who has not yet come to accept your free gift of salvation, that they would be convicted by the word this morning, that you would open up their eyes to see and their ears to hear, that you would give them a new believing heart of repentance and faith. I pray that our hearts as brothers and sisters in Christ would be encouraged, that we would be rooted and grounded in love and built up in our faith, that we would love one another and serve one another for the glory of Christ alone. Amen.
Acts chapter 11. We'll start reading in verse number 19. Now those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who on coming to Antioch, spoke to the Hellenists also, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. The report of this came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. When he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad, and he exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. And a great many people were added to the Lord. So Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. For a whole year they met with the church and taught a great many people. And in Antioch, the disciples were first called Christians. Now in these days, prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch, and one of them, named Agabus, stood up and foretold by the Spirit that there would be a great famine over all the world. This took place in the days of Claudius. So the disciples determined, every one, according to his ability, to send relief to the brothers living in Judea. And they did so, sending it to the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul. If you were with us many weeks ago when we began this study in the book of Acts, you may recall that in Acts chapter 2, we had the opportunity to look at a snapshot of the early church in Jerusalem. And Luke described for us a picture of what life in that church looked like, and we found it remarkable. We found it encouraging and at the same time challenging to look at where we are today compared to what they were then, and I think if we were honest, we were a bit convicted, but at the same time, we felt, I think, a thirst, and I think a joy and a thankfulness at what God was doing here in us. We get a similar opportunity again this morning. Though not in Jerusalem, now the focus shifts to a church in Antioch. Antioch was the capital of the Syrian province of the Roman Empire. It was north of Israel, north of Phoenicia. As a matter of fact, it sat kind of in the northeastern corner of the Mediterranean, right on the sea. It was the third largest city in the Roman Empire. It was big. It was well known. The only cities larger than Antioch were Alexandria in Egypt and Rome itself. And here in this large metropolitan and multi-ethnic city, the gospel takes root in a pretty remarkable way. Reminder right off the bat, in verse number 19, of how the gospel consistently spread And that consistent spread was not through the extraordinary means of the apostles, though we saw some pretty extraordinary conversions, haven't we? Paul being one, Cornelius, many others. But the ordinary and consistent spread of the gospel occurred by the steady faithfulness of God's normal people, right? The people that had left Jerusalem because of the persecution that arose there, they scattered across the region and around the Roman Empire, and as they went, they took the gospel with them. And it says that they went as far as Phoenicia, which was another Roman province just north of Israel, kind of that narrow territory along the Mediterranean as you head north out of Israel. Think of modern-day Lebanon. That's kind of where Phoenicia would be today, including cities like Tyre and Sidon that we're familiar with. And as far as Cyprus, it says, Cyprus is a little island that was roped into the Roman Empire as well. That island sat just south of Turkey in the Mediterranean Sea. And Antioch. So as people spread, they scatter across the region. They take the gospel with them. And we go from this story that we saw last week of God demonstrating his acceptance of the Gentiles into the church through the conversion of this man Cornelius and his household to Antioch, where Gentile conversion happened on a scale that had not yet been seen in the ancient world. So as we dial in on this church, I want to pull out just a few things as we take a look at a snapshot of what life was like in this body. We want to look at it. And then we want to ask ourselves the question, how do we compare? And where maybe do we need to adjust our focus, our efforts, to align with the will of God for Holiday Bible Church today? All right? So, first highlighted aspect of the Church of Antioch was their evangelism. Their evangelism. They were free with the gospel. All right? Now, it wasn't always that way, because it says that as these people spread across the region, there's this little phrase in there that's a bit of a disappointment. It says they spread to Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. They were kind of keeping it in-house, staying with people they were familiar with, maybe even convinced still that the gospel was for Israel only, maybe not familiar yet with the story of Cornelius and God's demonstration of his acceptance into the Gentiles. Whatever the reasons were, they went to their own kind. This is a problem we all struggle with, isn't it? We are most comfortable with those we are most like, those we have the most in common with. But that's a problem when it comes to sharing the gospel. And we've seen repeatedly through the book of Acts, and especially in the conversion of Cornelius, that the gospel is not limited by race, nor by the color of one's skin, as you see most likely in the Ethiopian eunuch, nor is it limited by language, as seen by Pentecost and speaking in tongues, nor is it limited by prior religious commitment, see the conversion of Paul, nor is it limited by physical health. Remember Aeneas, healed, given the ability to walk again. Nor is it limited by income. You see the Jerusalem church who had poor people and needy widows as well as wealthy landowners. The gospel is limited by none of these things, yet we attempt to limit it by our own generally soft prejudices. We like the comforts provided by sameness. Namely, I think, predictability and affirmation. Because when I'm around other people that are the same as I am, that are like I am, that think like I am, that prioritize like I do, that share a relatively similar culture that I have, that I seek out in my own life, when I'm surrounded by those people, I can better predict what they will be and what they will do, and I can be more certain that their doing and saying is going to affirm what I have already engaged in. I'm going to be confirmed in my activities. I'm going to be comfortable. With variety comes a level of unpredictability and confrontation. Now, we don't know the culture. They're going to think differently and respond differently than we do. They're more likely to disagree with the way that I view the world and the ways that I try to order my own slice of the world. The call of the gospel, folks, pushes against our natural tendencies towards sameness and draws us to the vast variety of the nations. Fortunately, there were some in Antioch who were not willing to simply seek out others like themselves. And they took the gospel to these diverse peoples in Antioch. It says these people that were willing to share the gospel with the Hellenists. Remember the Hellenists, they're the Greek speakers. They're those that were considered outsiders to Israel. But there were people who came from Cyprus, this island off of the coast of Turkey, and as far away as Cyrene, and they came to Antioch, and these were the people that preached the gospel to the non-Jewish population in Antioch. And I find that remarkable. Now, Cyrene was a good distance away. It was like if you draw a diagonal line from Antioch across the Mediterranean, you're going to land somewhere close to Cyrene. It was on the northern coast of Africa, what is in modern-day Libya. It was a good distance. We come across Cyrene a couple times in the scripture, though. One of them was in Acts chapter 2. They are specifically mentioned in Jerusalem at the time of Pentecost. It specifically places people from Cyrene in Jerusalem at that time. Acts chapter 6, they're mentioned again as people in Jerusalem from Cyrene who were part of the synagogue of the freedmen. And you remember them because they were the ones that Deacon Stephen tried to share the gospel with, and they ended up stoning him to death. But there are two very early occurrences of people from Cyrene hearing the gospel. And so the gospel makes its way back to this coastal city in Africa early. And now they're in Antioch, probably because Antioch is a major metropolitan city. It sits on a lot of trade routes through the Roman Empire. And so many people from many nations would pass through. Many people from many nations took up residence there. And these people from Africa, who had heard the gospel very early on in Antioch, go, wait a second. The gospel is not limited by race or skin color or cultural differences. And they begin to share the gospel with the Hellenists, with the non-Jews. What strikes me about this church is they were given to sharing the gospel freely. They had to learn. They had to overcome some soft prejudices. They had to overcome some comforts. They had to put themselves out there. But the result of that was that their church became, no doubt, a reflection of the community around them. What do I mean by that? I don't mean that there was no difference in the people that sat in the pews and the people that were on the outside, right? Like people came into the church, just continued to live life however they want and just joined a different band of people to hang out with. There were clear differences, But when you looked out across the crowd, I think, and I don't think we can escape the idea that this church body looked an awful lot like the community did. It was just a slice out of the cultural context of Antioch brought into the church. So there were people from, as one historian puts it, there were Greeks, Romans, Syrians, Phoenicians, Jews, Arabs, Egyptians, Africans, Indians, and Asians, all populating Antioch at this time. So however those demographics broke out, these people went out into the communities and shared the gospel with all of these varieties of nationalities, all of these cultural differences, all of these different peoples, and these peoples, it says, accepted Christ in large numbers. They were free with the gospel. And the result was the church, the membership of the church, reflected the community in which the church lived. They were reaching the people around them. We hear calls, and I think they're well-meaning calls, and I think they're calls that are to be appreciated and encouraged and lauded in many ways, but we hear calls to multi-ethnic congregations. And that's good and right, but not always practical. Just by virtue of where a church is located might limit the possibility of multiracial attendance. But what churches should be called to do is share the gospel across all of these very natural and comfortable divides that tend to be in our communities. We ought to ask, what does our community look like? What does our church look like? And why is there such a vast difference sometimes? So this first aspect of this picture of the church at Antioch pushes on us a little bit, doesn't it? It pushes on our comforts. It pushes against our natural tendency to go to people the same as us. Now listen, on the other end of the spectrum, it doesn't mean that if you're like me, I'm going to shun you now. But what it does mean is that I need to be really careful that I'm not refusing the gospel to those ready and able to receive it because of a cultural division that has creeped into my heart. This church had to learn how to be free with the gospel. And it took outsiders coming in, going, hey, there's a problem here. And whether you do it or not, we're taking the gospel to the nations that are already present. We're taking the gospel to Chinatown and to the Irish sector. To the poor and to the outsiders, because the gospel knows none of those boundaries. Second aspect, they prioritized evangelism, but they also prioritized discipleship. They prioritized discipleship. As this church begins to form, many people start to come to faith in Christ. News spreads down to Jerusalem where the apostles were, and they decide to send Barnabas. Because who else, right? I mean, at this point in the book of Acts, who else besides the very son of encouragement himself to go to a fledgling church to encourage that church? Makes perfect sense. Barnabas arrives in Antioch.
And in verse 23, it says, when he came, he saw the grace of God and was glad. Man, what a great reminder that conversions and a healthy, vibrant church are not accomplished by great marketing and sales teams. They're accomplished by the grace of God, and Barnabas knew it. Barnabas saw what was going on in this church, and he attributed all the good that was happening to the grace of our Lord. It's also a great reminder that seeing the grace of God at work in this way is a source of great joy for his people. Which is a reminder that I think we need to remind ourselves of on a regular basis, because we so easily are deceived into thinking that joy is wealth or security or retirement or family or whatever the case may be. We so easily buy into that notion, and we run across a verse like this and we can easily run past it. But Barnabas found great joy in recognizing the grace of God at work in the church at Antioch. And I think it should cause us to desire even more to see souls saved, to see Holiday Bible Church grow in our own faithfulness to the Lord. Which means, by the way, that it should and will encourage our regular praying for God's grace. Right? You see the connection? Like if I'm truly joyful, if God's grace in his people is genuinely a source of joy for me, then doesn't it only make sense to ask for God's grace in his people? Doesn't it only make sense to ask God for more to be converted? We come back to that idea of, man, you know, my joy is bound up in the glory of God, isn't it? My highest good is seeking the glory of God. And oh, by the way, the two go hand in hand. God is interested in your joy. Christianity is not a call to abject misery, but it can be miserable if we miss the glory of God. This is one of the reasons why church is so important for the Christian. I don't know how often you run into people who claim to know Christ, but regular church attendance is not a part of their Christianity. I have found that, by and large, those people are just pretty miserable. Seeing God's grace in God's people is a source of tremendous joy, and we ought to pray for it regularly. You ought to pray for it regularly, that God's grace would be evident at Holiday Bible Church. You should pray regularly that the gospel would spread out from us, that more would come to glorify Christ by turning to him in faith. We should be praying for it. We should always be working towards that goal as we pray, trusting that God's grace is available. Barnabas rejoiced at the grace of God, and then he went to work. Right? This whole let go, let God sounds good, but it's really poor theology. Barnabas acknowledged the grace of God and the necessity of the grace of God if we are to be a healthy, vibrant, growing body. But then he started working to grow the body, to build the body by God's grace. See how those two things go together? We pray and ask God for his grace, and then we get busy trusting that his grace will be available. It's the necessity of grace. As he gets busy, it says in verse 23, the latter half of the verse, that he exhorted them to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. And we talk about discipleship. which is exactly what Barnabas starts doing here. It's exactly what had already been going on in Antioch, but when Barnabas gets there, he's like, this is what we need to do. We need to exhort you through the scripture to be faithful to the Lord. He didn't show up and go, I am the discipleship expert. Here's a 10-week course on discipleship. If you make it through this 10-week course, we give you a certificate, and you are a disciple. Or discipled, as if the job is done. He didn't do that, and he didn't show up either with dress codes or dietary restrictions and go, if you do these things, you're a good disciple. Now, what's he do? He exhorts them to be faithful. To be faithful to the Lord. Hey, this is really the essence of discipleship, isn't it? What does it mean to be a disciple? What is very basic sense, a disciple is simply someone who attached themselves to a teacher, and they followed that teacher, and they followed his sayings, and they learned from him, and they learned how to live and teach themselves. And so they buy into the philosophy. And so a disciple of Christ were people that attached themselves to Jesus, and they followed him. They heard him speak and teach, and they bought into what he had to say. And so at the very root of discipleship is this idea of faithfulness, that we will continue to follow those things, because the minute that I cease to be faithful to my teacher, I'm no longer a disciple. I've given my allegiance to somebody else or something else. It's a matter of faithfulness. So I think it's reasonable to assume that Stephen, as he's encouraging them towards faithfulness, is pointing them to the scriptures, that at least the scriptures that they had in their possession, and they're looking at what God has to say, and Stephen is encouraging them, stay faithful to the Lord. Be resolute. Don't turn away. Believe your teacher. Obey your teacher. Do not leave your teacher. Be faithful to the Lord. Stephen himself was an example of this faithfulness. Stephen gave himself to disciple these people in a foreign city because in verse number 24 it says, he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. What does it mean that Barnabas was a good man? And we talked about this a few weeks ago. If you were here on Wednesday night for our study through the fruit of the Spirit, just by the way, a little plug, we have one more fruit left. So if you're available, not this Wednesday night, but the following Wednesday night, we're going to wrap up that study. But we spent an entire Wednesday night discussing this idea of goodness. And I don't want to rehearse everything that we learned that night, but goodness, kind of the highlight here, goodness is the very essence of the character of God. All that God does is good. And when we read of God's goodness in the scripture, it's his pouring out his riches freely with purity of heart. It's a display of his glory to his people. Good in our terminology means, today's a good day, right? It's a good day because compared to yesterday, can't be that bad. Or compared to the rest of the week when I had to go to work, today's a good day, right? We use it in this comparative sense. Well, can I have a good car? What do we mean by that? It gets the job done. It gets me from point A to point B. Hasn't left me stranded in a while. It's a good car. But the word good for us is not really impressive. We have other words to describe really impressive things, right? We're like, that, it's an amazing car. This is a terrific day. It's outstanding. And we have all these other words to describe, and so good for us just kind of loses its luster a little bit. So we have Stephen was a good man. And I think maybe in our cultural way of thinking, I was like, well, you know, he hasn't left his family probably. Shows up to church regularly. He's doing some good things. But when the scripture uses this term good, what it means is that Barnabas had a recreated heart. Remember in Ephesians, it says that when we become old, things are passed away and all things become new, right? So this heart that is described in the book of Jeremiah is just full of deceit and sin. Like, we can't even trust our own heart. That heart gets recreated. And in Ephesians, it says it's now created in the image of God, in the likeness of God, and in true holiness and in truth itself. And that's good, right? That's goodness of a completely different kind. So Barnabas has this recreated heart that was itself full of God's goodness. He received the goodness of God. And that goodness fills Barnabas' heart and then flows out into good deeds. Flows out into right service and love activity towards other people. This is the constant narrative of Barnabas' life, by the way, in the book of Acts. We saw him in Acts chapter 4 when he sold a property and gave all the proceeds to the church. We saw him in Acts chapter 9 when he meets Saul, the persecutor, and advocates for him at the church in Jerusalem, brings him alongside. And now we find him traveling to a distant city to encourage new converts in a fledgling church. He was a good man. His heart was full of God's goodness, and it overflowed in acts of kindness to other people. He was full of the Holy Spirit. That's who gets credit for Stephen's goodness, right? Where goodness is a fruit of the Spirit, which means it comes from the Spirit. The Spirit of God gets credit for all of the goodness that Barnabas was able to do. And he was full of faith, without which it is impossible to please God, we're told in Hebrews 11. The result of God's grace here in Antioch, the result of God's grace in Barnabas's life, the result of the faithfulness of his people in both teaching and receiving his word is found in verse number 24. And a great many people were added to the Lord. That was the result. They gave themselves to evangelism. As people are coming into the church, they begin now to give themselves to discipleship, encouraging one another to remain faithful to the Lord. So when you hear the term discipleship, don't get freaked out, okay? Like I said, it's not a 10-step course. It's, hey, why don't you come alongside me and let's encourage each other through life to remain faithful to the Lord. And put in those terms, you can do that. You can do that with somebody today. When you go, well, who's going to be the disciple and who's going to be the discipler? Yes! Right? At this point, I don't even care. Just do it. Because what you're going to find is this mutually beneficial relationship. As you push each other into the scripture and encourage each other to faithfulness. Barnabas decides he needs the help. He needs some help. There's all these people who are coming to know Christ. And rather than sending back to the Jerusalem church and requesting help from them, something in Barnabas's mind goes, hey, we're not that far from Tarsus. As a matter of fact, Tarsus might be closer than Jerusalem. Who do we know that's in Tarsus at the moment? Saul. Because Barnabas put Saul on a boat in Caesarea and sent him home because they were trying to kill him. But Barnabas never forgot about Saul. And now he travels to Tarsus and says, hey, Saul, we got work to do. And he brings him back to Tarsus with him. Tarsus, to Antioch. And it says that they spent a whole year meeting with the church and taught a great many people. And it is in Antioch the disciples were first called Christians. What a fascinating decision by Barnabas. I can't help but believe that Barnabas had a genuine love for this guy, Saul. that he wanted to help disciple Saul and encourage him in the ministry that God was going to give him to do. And so he goes to get Saul and says, Saul, come do this with me. Come alongside me. And that very act in itself is an act of discipleship. Probably required a lot of humility for Barnabas. There's no doubt he had seen Saul's giftedness already. And bringing Saul to Antioch probably meant that he would take a back seat in the public eye to Saul. Barnabas didn't care. Bring him in. God will use him to benefit the church. Barnabas was more concerned about the gospel and the glory of Christ and the love of others than winning any popularity contest. He was more interested in encouraging Saul in his giftedness than exalting himself and his own gifts. Requires love, doesn't it? Requires me to love others more than I love myself. If we are to be a church given to discipleship, like the church in Antioch, we must love one another more than we love ourselves. You ever tried that, by the way? You ever heard a sermon on loving other people and you're like, I'm going to do it because I'm supposed to. Sunday afternoon is like, love people, love people, love people. By the time Monday morning rolls around, we're already exhausted. We're like, I just need some Netflix in my life. Some comfort food. It's hard. But it also reminds us again of the necessity of God's grace in this process, doesn't it? I can't love you that way. I can't. Apart from God's grace. They spent a whole year there. Discipleship doesn't happen overnight. Again, it's not a 6-week course. It's not a 10-week course. They spent a whole year investing in these people. They gave serious time and commitment. And it's no wonder that the Christians here, that the church here were, this is the first place they were called Christians. They were striving together for faithfulness to Christ, to be disciples of Christ. They were learning about Christ. They were speaking to other people about Christ. Their lives were centered around Christ. And it's like the unbelievers were looking at them going, what is up with these people? It's all they talk about. It's like they're consumed by the so-called Christ Jesus. They're like little Christ followers. Disciples of this Christ. Christians. And the Christians were like, exactly. That's exactly what we are. It's exactly what we're doing. As a matter of fact, we'll take that name. And we'll wear it as a badge of honor. We are his disciples. We are his followers. One of the most important places, when we think about this discipleship and how we get involved and where we get involved, one of the most critical places to do this is in our own homes, particularly those who have young kids. I mean, it's just, when you talk about bringing people alongside to live life with you, and God is just like, here's a couple kids, right? And a husband or a wife. Go disciple. Let me tell you, that is not a 6-week course. Some of you have grown kids, and you're like, it ain't a 40-year course, brother. They were free with their time, weren't they? They were free with their time to give time to encourage one another to be faithful. They prioritized evangelism. They prioritized discipleship. In verse number 27, kindness was just like the air that they breathed. Verse number 27, it says, now in these days, prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch, and one of them named Agabus stood up and foretold by the Spirit that there would be a great famine over all the world. And this took place in the days of Claudius. We have some historical context here, some historical evidence of such a famine spreading across the Roman Empire. Which is really important. We come across, we hear the term prophet, and we think Old Testament, and we got to remind ourselves that the book of Acts is a bit of a transition period. The full revealed scripture, word of God, is not available to the church yet, and so there were still people that were speaking the unknown truth of God to his people at the time. And one of the tests of a prophet was whether or not what you prophesied came true, right? So in Deuteronomy 18, Moses says, if you say in your heart, how may we know that the word of the Lord has not spoken? Because just prior to this, by the way, he says, if someone speaks and it's not the word of the Lord, then just don't even pay attention to that, right? So the question would be then, well, how do we know if they're speaking the word of the Lord or not? And he says in Deuteronomy 18, 22, when a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the word does not come to pass or come true, that is a word that the Lord has not spoken. The prophet has spoken presumptuously. You need not be afraid of him. And a couple verses later, it says, oh, by the way, you should stone him. It always makes me interested. I had a guy come to me in the Atlanta airport and said he had a prophecy for me. And I always wonder what became of him, because that prophecy has not yet come true. I'm 42. Time is running out. And it's not looking real great. I doubt he's been stoned by his people, though. This famine hit the whole Roman Empire. And so the disciples, in verse number 29, determined everyone according to his ability to send relief to the brothers living in Judea, and they did so, sending it to the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul. This may be one of the most remarkable verses in this passage. Because here's a church in Antioch that was initially discriminated against by people coming from Jerusalem and Judea. They are the ends of the earth. And now they are taking their own resources that has probably been affected by this famine as well and sending it back to the epicenter of Christianity to care for the people who are living in those towns, the people who are part of those churches. They sent it by the hand of Barnabas and Saul. Again, we're not surprised that Barnabas is in the middle of another relief effort, are we? It's just what he does. A couple of things I want us to note about this giving. Number one, everyone gave according to their own ability. Right? There was no set amount, which means some people probably were able to give a lot. Some people were probably only able to give a little. But they all gave something, and they all apparently then gave willingly. Not out of compulsion, like 2 Corinthians 9 tells us to do. But they all gave something. And I want to pull out, and I want to be careful how we do this, but they directed their giving to the churches, right? This was not a global relief effort. They were targeting churches for the relief. For the relief of the brothers and sisters who were living in Judea. This is kind of reflected in Galatians 6, verse 10. So it says, so then as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. It does not mean that we close our hearts and wallets to those who are not saved, but it does mean that we ought to be ready and willing to give for the relief of our brothers and sisters in Christ, and that they ought to have the priority in that giving. It's kind of like the family, right? Like the family first kind of thing. Like, I'm more willing and probably more ready to give to a family member in need than a random stranger. And I'm probably willing to do more for the family member. We live in a household of faith. And listen, I want to be helpful and a bit honest here also and understand that it's difficult to know how to do this sometimes, isn't it? It's hard to know when and how to give. In verse number 30... And here's where I want to be really careful, because this is by no means a command. But in verse number 30, it says that they sent the relief by the hand of Saul and Barnabas, and they delivered it to the elders of the church. Why? Well, for one, the elders, with the support of the deacons, would have known precisely where the needs were and who had genuine needs versus maybe those who needed it less. Here's where I want to just put this out there. When someone comes and asks for financial help from you, and you have the means to do so, then you also have the freedom to help that person. You can open your wallet and by God's grace, with God's grace, for God's glory, do something about that person's situation. Maybe that means you can pick up a bag or two of groceries. Maybe you could even take care of a phone bill or an electric bill. But maybe you can't help. Maybe the need is a little bigger than that. Or maybe you're wondering what exactly is going on. Then I want to just put the offer out there that when that happens, I want you to feel free to bring those individuals, just walk them up to one of the elders or even one of the deacons and go, hey, I've just been made aware of so-and-so's need. I wanted to bring them to you so you could hear. Because when that happens, we have a procedure that we follow. We want to be helpful where we can, and our combined resources sometimes, we're able to do that better than individuals and their resources, but it also gives the opportunity to do a little investigation and maybe provide some discipleship along the way. Maybe some teaching opportunities for some people who maybe their resources ought to be sufficient to cover their needs, but they're not very good at it. We've had some of these opportunities over the years. There's been some of these opportunities where we've connected them with people who are really gifted in finances, and they've been able to walk together for a while, and I think it's been life-changing for some of them. And the financial needs have lessened because they were able to gain some wisdom. But there's also been some occasions where when we start digging around, we find there's just some really unwise and maybe even ungodly activity going on. I remember one instance where, you know, the person just month after month after month didn't have money to pay their electric bill. And when we started diving into the resources and the income, it's like, well, of course you can't, because you can't stop spending money at like the Home Shopping Network and QVC and Amazon. Like, if we cut that stuff out, you got more than enough coming in. And folks, we're not a wealthy church by any stretch. We do have to be wise in how we use our resources. But we do want to use our resources. We do want to use them for the benefit of God's people where we can, for the spread of the gospel where we can. It's our snapshot, the church in Antioch. Prioritizing evangelism, free with the gospel. Prioritizing discipleship, free with their time. Prioritizing kindness, free with their resources. That's what this church looked like. Three questions for us as we close. Number one, what should Holiday Bible Church look like? What should we look like? It's kind of an obvious question. If church should look like its community, what should we look like? Well, our community, 78% white, 12.5% Hispanic, 7% black, less than 2% Asian. That's the demographics of where we are. The median household income is $36,000 a year. That's almost half, by the way, of the median household income for the state of Florida. 11% of our population do not finish high school. Only 18.5% attain a college degree of some sort, either associate's or bachelor's degree. Residents in Pasco County are 76% more likely to die of an overdose compared to the rest of the country. That's our community. It's where we are. Which means what we ought to expect is that the people being reached by the gospel look like this. Which means we have to take the gospel to people who look like that. Question two, how are you spending your time? Would someone accuse you of being a Christian because of the time that you designate to following Christ? Discipling other people. Are you seeking out others that you can come alongside and disciple or perhaps be discipled by? I know that's a bit of an intimidating thing, right? We just walk up to someone one day and be like, will you disciple me? That's awkward. I mean, you could do it. I'd totally back you up on it too. But it's a bit awkward, and I get it, and not everyone's going to do that. But you're like, man, I get this thing, and I want to do it, and I want to participate, and I don't know how. Then let me, again, put it out there to you. Come talk to me. Come talk to Mike. Come find Trevor and talk to him. We would be more than happy to help connect you or give you some recommendations of people who are maybe on the other end of things and looking to connect, looking to build and establish those kinds of relationships. The same goes to those of you who are maybe going, you know what, I think I could be a help to somebody. Particularly based on what we said this morning, just living life together and encouraging each other to faithfulness. But I don't know where to start. I don't know who to start with. Come talk to one of us. We'd be more than happy to point you in a direction and give you some options. Help connect you to some people. Question number 3, how should we give? We should be free with the gospel. We should be free with our time. We should be free with our resources. And we live in uncertain times, don't we? We don't know what tomorrow's going to bring. It seems from one day to the next, we don't know what's going to happen in the economy. We don't know what's going to happen with pandemics. We never know when another shutdown's going to come. We never know how our wallets and our resources are going to be affected. And yet, in the midst of that turmoil, here's a church trying to support for the first time a pastor and you know, a wife and 4 kids. That is no small undertaking. Folks, we need God's grace to be able to make these determinations wisely, to know when and where and how to give. And when we do, it should be willingly and joyfully, knowing that it is for God's service and it is by God's grace. Folks, this is church. This is a snapshot of one of the most remarkable churches that we have record of. Let's pray by God's grace that we measure up. Let's pray, Lord, these things are challenging to us. I think seeing this church hits us in our comfort zones. Pushing ourselves outside of what is comfortable for us to share the gospel, it's not an easy thing. Giving up our time to invest in the spiritual good of others is not an easy decision to make. We are pressed for time in our society. We are told that we should be busy. We are told that we should be productive, that we should do more, that we should budget our time more wisely to squeeze more in. And Lord, I know in my own heart that when I begin to buy into some of those notions, that what gets squeezed out is time with other people. So God, help us as your people to be free with your people in the use of our time. And Lord, having resources gives us security. At least we feel it does. Lord, I pray that you would loosen our grip on such things. Teach us that true security, real security, comes from knowing Christ, from being redeemed. And Lord, in that knowledge, may we grow in your grace. May your grace abound on your people more and more. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, all who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. Amen. Thank you for joining us this morning for our worship service. In about 10 minutes, we will regather in here for Discovering God Hour, and the teens will meet over in the office area for our Sunday school class. Kids will meet in the children's room. God bless you. Have a great week. You are dismissed.